complete human information about nature, all scrambled up by Heisenberg and Bohr into an omelette. About the relevant circumstances to those quantities. last and not least, in what sense is the theory testable? And in particular, is the theory testable by someone who does not believe or does not yet believe that the Moscovitz has the branching structure that every etch in quantum theory says it has, who doesn't, as it were, buy into any of the claims of the theory? Right, so this is a bunch of questions that any philosopher really is going to ask about the Everett interpretation. But, and this is the punchline really, they will also ask, philosophers will also ask, the same questions, forget about the first one, the same questions about any physical theory in which there is a notion of probability or something objective in the world. I mean, briefly, philosophers have found it extraordinarily puzzling how it could be anything objective in the world that plays the role of objective chance seems it is better play. And the way that physicists get away with this, and a lot of people, most of us get away with it when we're not doing philosophy or philosophy of probability, is to be crude frequentists, simply to identify probabilities as relative frequencies, as objective things out there in the world. The problem with frequentism is it doesn't work. Okay, I'm not going to go into the background to that, or the arguments as to why frequentism doesn't work, it just doesn't hold up to inspection. So, what do you do when you give up on frequentism? Alright, so I'm going to address these questions more or less in order. But before I do so, I do need a bit of mathematical apparatus in order to be more careful in how to describe this branching structure of the quantum state. So in a word, what I need is the decoherent histress formalism. It's particularly useful, simple, intuitive. It gives a space-time representation of the quantum state. So think of the quantum state unitarily evolving in space-time, and think of what is the structure of that object. Okay, that's usefully provided by quantum histress formalism. And what that formalism does is essentially, it's a bit like a lattice. It sticks the quantum state onto a lattice. It discretizes time. It discretizes or coarse grains phase space. It takes von Neumann's building blocks of reality, and it constructs sequences of such projections acting on the state, and then the superposition of such sequences gives you back the total state. Okay, so let me just go through that. I'll be fairly quick, and if you find it puzzling, I'm sorry, I do need some schematic tools to discuss probability more accurately. So start off with phase space. So here is, we've got a coarse graining on it. So think of Gaussians, sharply peaked, localized in position momentum, and then integrate them over some region of phase space, and you'll get out a projection. Define Heisenberg picture projection operators. Okay, I'm sorry about the sign problem with this. To be equal manifest to you on the right. So what is happening here is, what this projector is doing, acting on the state in the Heisenberg picture, the state is something that doesn't change with time. We can think of it as the state at time zero. It could be the state of the origin of the universe, if we want. So ETHG is going to unitarily evolve that state forward to time t. The projection p alpha k is then going to act on the state. The state can be represented as a superposition of a part which is an eigenstate of p alpha k and a part which is orthogonal to that. So the part that is an eigenstate of p alpha k is what is retained, and then that state is taken back again to t equals zero. Okay. So a history is going to be a sequence of such projections. This is the normal notation for it. Often called chain operators. So c alpha alpha is a sequence of configuration of cells in phase space. Okay, and now put out of your mind Everett and quantum theory. Just pretend that you're doing something like, I won't call Copenhagen quantum mechanics. Max, I know, called Copenhagen quantum mechanics what Bohr was doing. I think Bohr was doing something rather different. I'm calling Copenhagen what Bohr was doing. So let me just call it the conventional projection gravity is, this much squared of this C alpha hitting the state, is going to be the probability of that history, where we can think of that history as developing through a sequence of measurements, each of them projective, each of them invoking the projection postulate, hitting the state with a projection operator. What is left is then, if you repeat the experiment, you'll get the same state. Then time evolved forward, hit it again with a projection operator into another cell in phase space. Again, unitarily evolved forward again. We have this discretization of time. When you look at the modular square of this thing, you're just getting the total probability for that history to evolve under that sequence of measurements. Okay, then you can define relative probabilities, the probability of a history, a concatenation of alpha and beta, so a sequence of regions of phase space. The beta is listing those, alpha, subsequent regions of phase space, divide the modular square of the potential state coefficient. So the relative probability of the history, alpha given beta. Okay. All right, now, the way this was developed back in the 90s, even earlier in the late 80s, with Bob Griffiths, William Omne, and Gavin Hartle. So the certain consistency condition is put into place. I'm calling it consistency, different terminology being used. Gavin Hartle called it decoherence. So orthogonality of these vectors corresponding to histories that differ, if only in one event along the sequence of events represented by these projection operators. It's a non-trivial condition, and it depends on what projections you use as to whether it's satisfied. And in the two-slit experiment, there it isn't satisfied. And in the case of the two-slit experiment, if you try to represent each of these histories, projection operator onto, say, a source particle at alpha I, what I've got there written is I for initial. If you have a projection operator onto region of phase space corresponding to the particle being at alpha 1, a second region of phase space corresponding to the particle being located at alpha 2, with a projection spread. And then finally, projection operator corresponding to the driver of the screen. So if you set up those histories and you calculate the probabilities of those histories, then it's simply not the case that the consistency condition is satisfied, which is exactly corresponding to the fact that we've had interference between the histories. So this consistency condition, we can understand it as a condition on non-interference of histories. Okay, and of course, in this two-slit experiment, as Feynman famously said, is contained, according to Feynman, all of the mystery of quantum theory, right, for a good part of it. Okay, so more terminology, a consistent, also called a decoherent history space, is going to be that each time we're going to have a resolution of the identity of a set of projections corresponding to regions of phase space, exhaustively mapping out the phase space. And the set of all such histories is then a decoherent history space, and if it's consistent anyway, we then have a measure on that space of histories which satisfies these nice summing conditions. Okay, so all that is not enough for the kinds of purposes we want. The general picture that I was putting in place yesterday, all of that is not enough. The consistency condition itself is much too weak. We have non-interference of histories, but we don't have anything like emergent, dynamical, robust structures propagating as patterns do the state. That is precisely what is given by quasi-classical domain in Gell-Mann-Hartle's terminology. So it's a consistent history space with a state sharply peaked on histories obeying approximately classical equations. Okay, so that's the thing that becomes relevant to the Navieriian interpretation of quantum theory, insofar as we can find such a history space of quasi-classical domain, such that the histories in that space correspond to actually also given the equations running along the histories, is hydrodynamic variables, where you're integrating local densities, which are approximately conserved. And it's by virtue of being approximately conserved that the equations for each history are approximately deterministic. Okay, so along this model, it's a sort of hydrodynamic model. We can imagine an inertial state for the system, which contains superpositions of macroscopically very distinct states. Decoherence of histories indicates that these states may be treated separately. We thus obtain a set of trajectories, which may be regarded as exclusive alternatives, each occurring with some probability. Those probabilities are peaked about the average values of the local densities. We've argued that each local density eigenstate may then tend to local equilibrium, and a set of hydrodynamic equations for the average values of the local densities then follows. We have obtained a statistical ensemble of trajectories, each of which obeys hydrodynamic equations. These equations can be very different from one trajectory to the next, having, for example, significantly different values of temperature. In the most general case, they could even be in different phases, for example, one gas, one liquid. Okay, and this is the sort of density complexity that you get into as soon as you back away from the highly idealized and carefully fabricated von Neumann-type measurement process. Actually, the experiment's out of the picture altogether. Evidence interpretation's got nothing special to do with experiments. Experiments are just one physical process among others. Very special ones, as I say, very carefully choreographed ones. But in general, this is the sort of situation, at least in the hydrodynamical case. Right. And one can, there are many other models, typically models, linear models, between oscillators and so forth, models of Brownian motion, heat valves quite generally, in which you get out the sorts of equations that you would expect to read the various histories involved. Okay, but look at the red sort of comments. Those are the squeaky scapegoats, really. But, so what do we mean by average value here? This is not bringing in probability. So there's a worry. There's a worry that in performing this sort of analysis, in the kinds of operations that one makes, taking expectation values, taking the partial trace, and so forth, is that not smuggling in a probabilistic interpretation of the theory? Okay, so that concern, I think, is a perfectly reasonable one. I'm not immediately going to lay it to rest. I think it's one that needs to be attacked, really. But you need the big picture in order to see what's going on. I would just say this much, though, that, I mean, really, if one's taking, first of all, let me just make a comment about coarse graining. So, if I take, by alpha bar, what I mean is a parameterization of a sequence of cells in phase space, then I can choose a coarser graining in phase space. And if I look at C alpha for contained within that coarser graining, so I'm going from fine graining in phase space to a coarser graining, then I have a simple relationship of this form. If I look at the probabilities of history alpha, I can also consider the probability of a coarser grained history. And if I can write it in this form, that's the consistency condition. So, in a certain sense, what's going on with the decoherent history space, consistent histories formalism, and the consistency condition is a very nice, very natural formalism for coarse graining, fine graining, in a way that preserves simple additive relations of these forms. And what I mean by P probability at this point is no more than a number, numerical values that are attached to histories which have yet to be interpreted as probabilities. And what I mean by a partial trace is a certain kind of coarse graining, where I integrate out over certain variables, retain others, a certain kind of coarse graining. Okay, so none of those concepts, I think, need involve probability. That's the essential claim. Right, well, if we can at least run with that, going back to my little constellation of topics surrounding probability, what I'm replacing the dice by is this branching structure. And this branching structure, we can imagine it as just consisting of these sequences of projection operators, these chain operators, acting on the state. So C alpha acting on Heisenberg picture state is going to return, I can write a subscript alpha if I like. This is going to be the quantum state from the formal point of view of the quantum state, but it is encoding all of this okay, corresponding to a history which could be from Big Bang right up to the present, with the condition that these vectors are orthogonal to one another when alpha, when the alpha is different, when the history is different in any respect. And then it should be clear, it's not already obvious, that if I sum over alpha, C alpha, psi, of course, I just get back psi. Because summing over all C alphas, I'm just summing over projection operators. I can do it sequentially, starting from the latest projection operators, sum over all of those, get unity, then go to the time before, sum over those, get unity, then work my way through all of these sequences. I'll just get back the original state. So from an Everettian point of view, we just have the total superposition of these histories, and these vectors represent each representing histories. And I'm just giving that a nice, I hope it's nice, graphical illustration there. Three histories I've got. But look, here's one of the big differences with the appeal to von Neumann measurement processes and the analysis of world as corresponding to measurement outcome. In no sense are there as many worlds produced in measurements as there are distinct outcomes. Okay, so that's an inappropriate model. What we're looking at here, these histories are corresponding, let's say, to regions of phase space. These regions of phase space it's just about the smallest, molecule displaced by a nanometer or two sitting on the edge of the apparatus. That's going to do to give a distinct history from one of that molecule, which would have nothing to do with experiments. It's not so displaced. Okay, so what is really going on all the time, and what is going on in the world as well, is branching structure involving countless amount of different histories. Perhaps with so the question, what is the number of branches produced when performing a measurement, is poorly defined. One can make it sharply defined in terms of the specific coarse grounding one puts on the phase space. But that's clearly an artifact of, as it were, putting quantum mechanics on the lattice. Right. Okay, so let me just start off. I want to just cover two or three of the philosophical topics. I don't want to spend much time on them. I think most of the interest is with measurement. The nature of this conference is really directed to cosmology, and I will conclude with, I think, one of the things that results from Everettian quantum theory vis-a-vis probability is a critical stance on the way that the concept of probability is being used in cosmology. So that will be what I'm heading for, what I'm going to try to conclude with. But along the way, I think I've got to say a bit about these philosophical topics. So I'll start off with time. Time, identity, and language are all related, really, in the question of how do we make sense of probability at all? Right, so I go back to the block universe and what I had up yesterday, and I think what is a spectacularly mistaken, bad thing to say about the space-time representation of the block universe that we see there due to what was now. Here's more bad things that you can say about space-time as a structure with world lines running through it. So you can conclude, well, there's no change. The notions past, present, and future have no meaning. There is no becoming. There is no free will. One can do that. And many philosophers have done that. They throw up their hands at this kind of representation of physics is somehow inappropriate, or we've got a mistaken take on the physics. One of the reasons that I was attracted to the Everett interpretation, may I say, speaking as a philosopher, I thought it's a philosopher's job to take physics and use it to impact on philosophy rather than take philosophy and try to use it to impact on physics. The basic reason being I think physics has done better than philosophy. So, you know, those who push for hidden variables, those who push for dynamical collapse theories, are saying, look, we know a priori, or we know on the basis of antecedent intuition, pre-theoretic knowledge somehow, that the world has to be in a certain format, a certain kind of picture must be appropriate, and therefore the physics must conform to it. And I'm doing the opposite. I'm saying let's take the physics and see how it impacts on philosophy. And here's an example. Don't insist on some pre-theoretical understanding of time and use it to presumably dictate that there's something wrong with relativity. Do the opposite. Assume space-time relativistic four-dimensional perspective is entirely acceptable, is physically fruitful, has and instead try to figure out what the right thing to say is. And here are some right things to say. Change consists of relations among events through time, past, present, and future is, becoming is, free will is. One's going to give stories about those things. And here's a simple story to say about tense. What is the meaning of tense, past, present, and future, given this four-dimensional perspective? Answer, something philosophers often do to give content with truth conditions for statements. So the statement that E will happen uttered at S is true if E happens later than S. So pretty straightforward, you know, quite unsurprising prosaic, really. But now let's go to the branching universe. And again, you can conclude something similar. There is no probability. There is no such thing as uncertainty. There's nothing about which to be ignorant. So somehow, every edge in quantum theory has to be abandoned. That would be the implication. And if that means abandoning quantum mechanics as standardly formulated, then so be it. So this is the sort of move I'm resisting. Instead, let's look for something informative to say if the universe does have this branching structure. And then one's going to say this. Probabilistic events are branchings, and probabilities are relative weights of branches. And then one's going to tell a story about uncertainty, a story about ignorance. And of course, temporality is all mixed up in this. So we're going to have to lean on what we've understood already in the deterministic four-dimensional case without branching. Okay, so here's how to give an account of uncertainty. So truth conditions for E is uncertain, uttered by A and WK, is that A at S does not know which world is A's. Or putting it another way, as of S, in some branches E happens, in other branches it doesn't happen. So for that reason, therefore, E is uncertain. And that can be piled up into a characterization of what we mean by a personal thing, because of course physics doesn't really dictate how we use ordinary words. So here's how we can use the word personal thing. We mean a branch part, a part of a branch, an ordered pair, person branch or thing branch. And here I've given the denotation for it. And if that's what a thing is, if that's what an event is, here beta is describing some local event, or it could be describing a person, or perhaps a stage in a person's life. So it's up to us to find an appropriate way of translating ordinary words into, or giving truth conditions for ordinary senses in terms of the underlying physics. And this is a way that works just fine. Well, I've called this branching worlds, and by branching I mean to be neutral about metaphysical ideas as to how one's supposed to be thinking about possible worlds. Here's how philosophers tend to cash out, be explicit about the notion of possible worlds. Possible world semantics has proved extremely valuable in philosophy, mostly for dealing with modal questions, questions of possibility, necessity, and so forth, counterfactuals. So philosophers like to use possible world semantics. It's a formal system whereby one quantifies over possible worlds. The extreme, very few people believe it, the extreme view is that they actually exist. The more standard and prosaic view is that, well, no, they're not possible worlds like this world. They're linguistic entities or something else. But still the question arises, how are we to think of their parts? This is how metaphysicians think. And here's one way of thinking about it, that these worlds overlap. So, meaning that their parts, at this early time, I've given it by S, are numerically shared by these different worlds. Don't worry if you don't understand what this means, by the way. That's fine, really. It doesn't really, I mean, maybe it doesn't really mean anything in application to real physics. Because, you know, what are we supposed to think of parts of a dynamical process after all? Right? Or, well, I can say more on this vein, but let me just move on. Here's another way of thinking about these possible worlds, that they diverge. So they're not, they don't share parts that are numerically the same, they're just qualitatively the same. Okay, and of course, if the picture is diverging worlds, then very simply, what uncertainty consists in is, I don't know which world is mine. We don't know which world we're in. If you have the picture of overlapping worlds, then you might think, well, we're in all of the worlds that have the qualitative character that here in this room that we have. And then you might think, well, in what sense am I in one world rather than another? And then in what sense is there any meaning to the notion of uncertainty as to which world one is? So you can see how this goes. I don't think, in fact, I'm quite certain that this matter is dictated by the mathematical structure of quantum theory. I've given a formal model where this makes sense. I've given another formal model where this makes sense. And it's really up to us as to which one we choose to best make sense of our ordinary lives in the light of the physics. Okay. Right, so, I hope to have given you some idea of how time, questions of identity, questions of language kick in. Let me talk now about probability and the measurement of probability. I've got Handsome Is As Handsome Does up there. That's a nod to Dennett's quote. It's a question of functionalism. The idea is this. We are going to identify branching events and branch amplitudes, norm squares of branch amplitudes and ratios in those things as objective probabilities because they behave just like objective probabilities. Okay. And in particular, they're measured just like objective probabilities. And the beauty of the Eretian framework, and I don't think this is true of any other approach I've come across in quantum theory, is that once you've identified what objective chance is, namely chance events or branching events, values of chance and the norm squared, ratios and norm squared of the branches involved, once you've identified what those objective chances are, you can then ask, well, how on earth can I measure them? How can those values of those amplitude squares be registered at the macroscopic level? And that's a purely dynamical question. Just, you know, play around with the equations, try to figure out what sort of unitary interaction could there be that drives, if you like, transports amplitude squares onto something that a device can register at the macroscopic level. What kind of unitary evolution can do that? And how? So how can probability be measured? And look, here's a bunch of facts about probabilities that we all know, but now we can explain them. Here's one thing we know. We know we never measure absolute probability. Absolute probability for the universe, we know we never do that. We know that we never measure single case relative probability. When I say relative probability, I mean of one event rather than another event happening. So we just can't do that. Single case probability, we can't measure it. If we could measure it, we could signal faster than light and do all sorts of other things. We all know that there is no probability meter that can measure relative probabilities on repeated trials with probability 1. We know that too. You just can't do it. Throw a dice 20 times and you measure the relative frequency, but it is not the case that with certainty that relative frequency is the probability of the dice landing one way rather than the other. Why not? Why can't we do it?